vessel fram, and this picture is more than 120 years old, and hopefully it's Dr. Nansen and Hjalmar Johansen we see before that. It's it is at the time where it, when doing polar research was substantially more challenging than it is today. I mean, the whole idea behind this research was that to freeze down the Fram in the ice, and that the stream should take it over the North Pole, so they would be the first ones to cross the North Pole. They got frozen in too early, and Dr. Nansen and Hjalmar Johansen then went skiing to find the North Pole, and they didn't quite get there in time and spent more than a year on their own up on the North Pole before they came back to people and were away for more than 3 years. So, but it was a time also when the people basically thought that it was this was basically ice, and it could be interesting to research what was up there, but otherwise or not of so much importance. However, this has changed very much. This is an Indian view on how the importance of the era geopolitically today. It's from Shamsharan's very interesting book published earlier today. He, Mr. Charan is one of the leading Indian diplomats, and as you see, he thinks, given the high potential for values when it comes to oil, minerals and so forth, really the changes in the Arctic, not only when it comes to climate and so forth, but also when it comes to the shift of the economic center, it can influence that because of that. So what we see here is that even when you're sitting here in India, even when we forget about the climatic part of it, the Arctic is immensely more important than it was traditionally seen to be. And of course, it's very, very big resources, as you all, it's been mentioned before. It's oil, gas, minerals, very important fish resources. We have the biggest cod stock, for instance, in the world up there, the Russo-Norwegian cod stock, and we have very important shipping lanes. For us, for instance, it's three quarters of the fish we fish up there, and of course, much of the changes in the Arctic has to do with the melting sea ice, as you know, because it makes a lot of the resources much more accessible than they used to be. So that, of course, it's a big challenge. And the basically, when we read articles about the geopolitics of the Arctic, the writers try to focus on the potential for conflict up there, because it's so clear from all kind of textbooks that when you have these immense potential resources, there will be intense competition about it. And it's of course also for us who are Arctic countries, it's also important for our economy, because a big part of our population lives up there. We have, for instance, in for Norway's cases, around 10% of the population living north of the polar circle. So it's important for us to also develop the economy, so that to develop it in a sustainable way. And so that's also a very important consideration for us in this situation. So, and we see here, as you see the numbers, we have the population up there, and actually, well, 90% of the export revenues from fish comes up from up there. And it's for us, then it's extremely important, and that has been our approach to the region all the time. We are a small country. In this area is that peace, stability and international cooperation has to be the keys. And that's also why we have all the time tried to influence it, to internationalize the region in a way, to see that it, also the common good, which the Arctic does represent. That means that, for instance, there has always been a very strong focus on resource management. And it's interesting in a way to look at the situation there, because if you go all the way back to the Cold War, Norway was one of only two NATO countries with a common border with Soviet Union. And in spite of that fact, and there were high political tensions in periods, but in spite of that fact, we were able to develop a common management of the Russian-Norwegian cod-stock, so that it's today is the only sustainable cod-stock in the world, and it's actually bigger than it has ever been. And it's a very good kind of cooperation, because we both have understood the importance for our own economies that we are able to share this and cooperate with it. So it's a very good example of where you can actually overcome also some political hurdles for joint management. So one part of this thing to try to internationalize the Arctic, but also to build cooperation structure, because there is what was interesting when this discussion you had about the Himalayas. I mean, we think that the key basically to stable political relationships between countries is to try to establish as many forums where we do collaborate, because even in small areas, if you add it together, it adds to the whole. So that has always been a goal for us. Arctic Council, actually, strange to think about it, but it has only been around for 20 years. In the beginning also this was seen as basically a forum for experts, and there was no headlines when they met together. But this has changed very quickly, and of course that has to do with climate change, which has changed the whole geopolitical situation. But it's very interesting how it in few years has moved from being senior civil servants meeting there to politicians, even president of the United States when they are coming together. So the Arctic Council, from that point of view also, is a very interesting concept the way it is, because you have added together the directly involved states, but then you have added up a number of states, also Asian states, which have stakes in it. Because why do the Asian states have stakes in it? Well, one, because of the importance we know when it comes to climate change and so forth. So it's extremely important from that point of view. And that is of course something which makes this really a common good, which is very important to come. And from our point of view also, to have active participants in the Arctic Council from outside the region is very good also for what the kind of focus we have for the debates. And also for us to lift it up is that, well, on the one hand, it's important for us to have good resource management to be able to be, because we also have to take in consideration that we shall live from the resources here, and we shall protect our populations living there. But it's also very important that we have the greater good as a focus of what we are doing. This is just an illustration of all the kind of cooperation structures we have there. We have, for instance, the Barents Cooperation, which is, again, that's only some of the states and parts of the states, but to further economic cooperation, cultural cooperation between northern Norway, northern Sweden, northern Finland, and parts of Russia. Again, same kind of thinking. We have the Nordic Councils, and we are, again, trying to get as many cooperation for us as possible. So this is a key, and I think the fact that we have been able to do it, not only with Russia, have we been able to have the fish management agreement, but we have also got the sea border delineation after 40 years of negotiation. research cooperation with India. Of course, here it's a focus on the polar research, which is very important. And I mean, research has been an important part of us. We're trying to get as many as possible to establish themselves also on Svalbard, where we now have 9 countries with their own research situation. But it's important for me just to underline, we have had a very rapid growth in research cooperation with India. Not only that, but polar research, of course, is key, but also bioeconomy, environmental research, and we see now that, for instance, oceanic research is really an area for cooperation in the future. And that is here, this is just finished with a new research vessel of the Polar Institute, which we presented yesterday also, just to underline the fact that research will be a very central key, not only for our policy in the Arctic, but very much also, of course, for developing the relationship with India. And we appreciate very much the very strong growth in this. Thank you.